So they made it much more Commodore 64-like in its layout. In fact, it'd be quite funny to open it up and point and laugh at the chips, because it's a ridiculous waste of space.
Can we open it up?
Yeah, we can open this one up. Three simple screws in this one, but this one at some point is overheated. You can see the tracks of the motherboard on the case. It's no wonder this machine was dead when I got it. So this is one of my restoration ones, because that has absolutely killed the board. And yet it still amazingly worked.
There's a fair bit of space in there.
There is a lot of space in that. So of course it's a Commodore 64 case, just painted black with rather nice fetching charcoal grey keys. As you can see, I have heat synced the main processor. So that is an 8501 processor. This is the TED chip, which is the 8360. So that does all the sound, video, joystick, tape player, everything is on that chip really. And then we have the three chips next to it is the kernel ROM, the PLA, and the third one that escapes me. But a lot of things that can go wrong with this, apart from the two chips, that they're the ones that really need heat sinking straight away. These voltage regulators can crack a bit under stress. And also it's been known to kill one of these machines just pulling the joystick out while it's on. So if you need to adjust which joystick you have in there, you should really turn the machine off first. It can just put a bit of an extra strain on the TED that you don't need. So,
if you opened up a Commodore 64, it would fill that, would it?
It's a lot bigger. So, for instance, I think where the SID chip and everything is would cover this grill. That's the reason that grill's there. So, as you can see, we've gone from the little C16 machine, and they've literally just elongated the board so it fits all the ports. It's an evolution of the 116, yes. I believe it was given to Commodore of Japan again, who I think just thought, let's turn it into a replacement for the VIC-20. And there it is. There's absolutely no changes to the functionality between this and the C116. It's possibly a little less reliable because it hasn't got all the heat protection that the 116 has in. So if you get one of these, add your own heat sinks immediately. Also, I should mention as well that both the 116 and the Commodore 16 can be upgraded relatively easily to 64K. I've got one at home that's got like a little daughter board sits on top with the extra memory on, and it's got a posh little switch in there to switch between 16 and 64K. As far as I know, there is one single game contemporary to when these machines were about between 84 and 86 that does not work on both machines. As it actually says, Commodore 16. For some reason, it doesn't work on the +4. That might be something slightly to do with the ever so slightly different processors. There are ways to know whether you have got a dead TED or a dead processor in one of these. So if you turn it on and you've got a power light and you've got a totally black screen, then your TED is dead. If you've got a gray, slightly noisy screen, then your processor is at fault. Also, if we have a little look round the machine, the power lead now goes in the side, as does the joystick. We've got the cassette port, we've got the serial port for printer, as well as its own disk drive. It will use 1541 or any of the other Commodore disk drives will work on that. We've got the video out, the RF out, and then, much like the other Commodores, we have the cartridge port. So, there were not very many cartridge games released for the 264 series. There was one or two games. I think Scott Adams had all his adventure games released on cartridge. There's quite a fun puzzle one called Verzuzzles, a diagnostics cart as well. But what this is very handy for on the Commodore 16 and the Commodore 116 is expandable RAM packs. I know of only two games that ever used 32K and one of them's Bandits at Zero, where you just get slightly better sound effects. But getting hold of a 64K RAM pack for these machines now is nigh on impossible. I haven't seen one in the wild for years. So it's far easier to get them upgraded internally to 64K than to try and track down a 64K RAM pack.
How would that work in terms of the game itself then? Would there be a separate version if you've got a RAM pack? Would you load in something different, or would it just load more stuff
in? It just seems to load more stuff in. Also, there are very few versions like that that have got a little extra on there. I'm now struggling to find a 64K game, much as I did back in the day. Here we go. We've got this one here. So this is plus four only. So all these games are 64K versions of 16K games. If you had an expanded Commodore 16, they'd just load straight in. The Commodore plus four did have its own 64K games, but they weren't very numerous. What tended to happen was you got games for the machine that sold by far the best. And the machine that sold by far the best was the Commodore 16. It was far cheaper. Commodore actually didn't make as many mistakes with it, particularly in the UK. And this is where we see all these, most of the games say C16 stroke plus four, so they'll work on either. Commodore in America, I don't think they did much with it. Far more successful were Commodore of UK, who sold it very, very well as a learning computer, as your first computer. And it was a pretty reasonable price. So I think they tried it at £129 first. It very quickly went down to £89, and it sold, particularly over a Christmas period in 85, really well. There's a lot of things on the internet. It was a total disaster. It didn't sell. But one of the biggest software houses in the UK at the time was Mastertronic, and they were sending messages out to their freelance programmers, can we get some software for this machine? For some reason, it's selling like hotcakes. Can we get some games sold? And in the end, I think Mastertronic produced some 53 games for it, which they certainly wouldn't have been bothering to do that if the machine had been a total disaster sales-wise.
And Mastertronic, in my memory, so I remember having one or two of these titles, were kind of pocket money games, weren't they?
They were. So these were like $1.99 each. I think we've got one of the biggest sellers, certainly on Commodore 16 here, was Rockman, which is a Boulder Dash clone. So most of these ones are $1.99. There is the odd one here. So we have one on the MAD title. So Mastertronic Added Dimension. These were a bit posher. These are like $2.99. Big money. Also, Mastertronic were also doing little compilations. I mean, this did an absolutely brilliant version of Pac-Mania. Or another huge seller, Formula One Simulator. It's totally different to the other versions, because Mastertronic and a few other companies, we've got Gremlin Graphics, who did games like The Magician's Curse. They seem to really understand the machine, and they play to its strengths. So nice, colourful, short little action games.
There are always amazing artwork on the front of these games, and then you'd see that picture and then you'd turn it over straight away and say, what did it actually look like?
Yeah, we've got a good example here. So we've got Gun Law, the actual game then. It's incredibly slow to play. And also, to keep the memory down, you couldn't move diagonally. So you can move up, down, left and right. So there was no diagonal control.
Should we load one up?
Yes. What should we have a go at? I do actually want to show you what is one of the most criminally awful games, but I can understand why it was criminally awful, because they tried to cram it into one load, Green Beret. So they never bothered with a full price release of it. These are the advertised screens on the back. So Spectrum version there, I think that's BBC, Amstrad and Commodore, I think. Now, let's have a look at the Commodore 16 version.
I'm cringing already. We haven't even put it in the tape deck.
If anyone knows what Green Beret should look like, I wouldn't be at all surprised if the tape player chews it up in disgust. So to give you some idea of the difficulty with the game, all the weapons apart from a knife are missing from the Commodore 16 version. So everyone's coming at you with guns and you have literally only got a knife to ward them off. Obviously, graphically, you're severely compromised, sonically as well. So I think there's one sound effect in this entire game. And detail in the graphics, you couldn't have too much detail, which is why the horror of what you're about to see makes... You've literally got wireframe graphics. It looks like it's been written in BASIC. Sorry to whoever wrote Green Beret for singling this game out, but it is a great demonstration. A lot of the machines at the time, they were increasing their memory, and then Commodore took this somewhat backward step, trying to basically turn their, what should have been a cheap business machine, into something it wasn't really capable of being. Right, here we go. You can already see the lack of sprite capabilities is the first problem, so everyone's got a huge black mark around them. Let's try and get a bit further. I think he's only got about 4 frames of animation as well. As more and more things appear on the screen, obviously we're starting to struggle. Oh, I don't know what killed me then.
Got shot from behind.
Oh,
shot
did
from
I?
The back.
And of course, yes, and I've only got a knife. So it's the whole thing of bringing a knife to a gunfight, isn't it? It really is. It's just...
What else is there to say about the 16? If it was a flop in the States, did they have other plans then?
So for the Commodore 16, not really. So it sold for a couple of years pretty well in the UK and a couple of other countries, and then Commodore quietly binned it. But at least it was far more successful than its larger brother. I want to do a shout out to a couple of programmers. So I'm going to load in a game called Arthanoid. And this is by a guy who any Commodore 64 owner should know, Sean Southern, Microchip Software, who, if it hadn't been for Sean Southern and a couple of others, Udo Gertz.